I'd like to tell you a story about the young immigrant girl that became a scientist. This story is actually about me and how I got the opportunities that many girls in my generation with my background did not. I think my story is important to share with you because during the last years, Europe has faced a mass immigration, and there are a lot of debates about how we could welcome the newcomers, but at the same time, keep our unique welfare system that we have built up here in Sweden. I was born in the 9 million city of Tehran, the capital of Iran, and I lived there the first 9 years of my life. Although I wasn't that old when we left Iran, I have a lot of different memories from my life back then, especially from my relatives and from my friends. If you know an Iranian, and I think many of you do, because Iranians are everywhere, we are everywhere. And we have a lot of relatives, and we especially talk about our cousins very often. And what I have to tell you now is that not all of them are actually our real cousins. Some of them are, but many of them are our cousins' cousins, our cousins' kids, our parents' kids, our friends' cousins. Yeah, this list is very long. But these people, they meant a lot for me during my childhood when I grew up in Iran. I remember playing with my cousins, going to school, doing my homework, activities that actually didn't differ much from the life that I got when we moved to Sweden. But what changed was that the number of cousins significantly decreased, and also that the setting changed a lot. So the setting that changed was that I was living in a country that was in war, and we moved to a country that was not in war. The strongest and the most horrifying memories that I have from the war are the nightly airstrikes. We were living in a 5-story long building, and we had these dark blinds covering the windows so that our apartment wouldn't be visible at night. And we always slept with the radio on. Because if the alarm went on the radio, it warned us about the coming airstrikes. And when we heard the alarm, we ran down to the basement and hid and waited, hoping that the bomb wouldn't hit us or anyone else, for that matter. I remember that usually the day after these airstrikes, that you could see crashed windows and crashed buildings in the city, and also that we sometimes left Tehran to go to the countryside where the risk of getting bombed was lower. So, if you imagine, living like that was not safe. So my parents, they decided to leave their jobs, their home, everything that they had built up, to go to somewhere safer. Similar to what many, many, many people are doing today. So, in 1987, we came to Stockholm. And my parents, they chose Sweden because Sweden is a safe country. But guess what? They also chose Sweden because my cousin lived here. And this is actually a real cousin of mine. I remember that living in the refugee camp was not really a pleasant place to be in. And fortunately, we didn't need to live there for long because of my cousin's generosity, we could stay in his apartment in Stockholm. And thanks to that, my sister and I, we were able to start an ordinary Swedish school and in that way get a much quicker integration than we would have otherwise. I got a lot of new friends, and my friends, they were wonderful. They welcomed me to their homes, and I felt partly included, and I felt that I was welcome here. Another way for me to start feeling included into the country was to learn the language. And I learned Swedish in school, and I had two teachers that helped me. One that taught me Swedish before the school day, and the other one that taught me Swedish during math class. Not because math is not important, because it is, but my math was quite ahead compared to my new classmates. So by individualizing my school day for a month or two, my teachers did this brilliant thing to teach me Swedish in a really efficient way. So this way I also felt that I was included into the country and I felt welcome. So school went well for me. And I soon realized that natural science, that was my call. So after 12th grade, I started studying molecular biology at Stockholm University. And then after that, I did my PhD in medical biochemistry at Umeå University. So a common path for people in my field is to do something called postdoctoral studies. This is studies after your PhD. And I went to Princeton and Princeton University to do my postdoc. I went to one of the world-leading labs studying chromosome stability, and I loved that place. It was a fabulous atmosphere and wonderful place to be in. So as you hear, for my higher education, I moved voluntarily twice. Once within Sweden, so from Stockholm to Umeå, and the other time to another country, so from Sweden to the States. And both these places, Princeton and Umeå, made me feel welcome very right away. And that was because I knew the language, I had a job where I studied, and this is not very common for a newcomer that is escaping the war. So, why me? Why did it go well for me? I think thanks to the people that I had around me that supported me, encouraged me, and taught me Swedish, I had less barriers to climb over to reach my goals. I was also highly motivated because I knew what my parents had left and sacrificed for us, and also that the opportunities that I have in here in Sweden are really unique, and you can't find them in so many places in the world. But my motivation comes also from the prejudice and discrimination that I have faced from my surrounding because of my unusual name, or that I don't have a typical Swedish look. Unfortunately, I feel that I have to work a little bit harder than my friends with a Swedish appearance. And also, if I would do something wrong, which I would never, but that I would be judged by my origin and not by the person that I am. And these feelings are not very nice feelings to go around with, but on the other hand, they have partly been a driving force for me to do even better. Last year, I was selected as one of the Wallenberg Academy Fellows in Medicine. So this is a very prestigious prize, and I was thrilled when I heard that I have been selected for this prize, and I still am. This is kind of being selected to play in the national soccer team and get to play in the World Cup and to dominate or Zlatanize. So thanks to this award, I can study my favorite proteins and their function on DNA and what this means for human health. So as you see, I have got the chance and I got the opportunities to do something that matters. And wouldn't it be wonderful if we could give this opportunity to the kids and teens, to the new Swedes that are coming here, so that they would also get a quick integration into our society? Maybe if we could be their mentor for a day, a week, or a month, we could help them into a quick integration and less isolation. In my research, I study a motor protein that paves the way for the DNA replication machinery. The DNA replication machinery functions as a machine, a typing machine, that types our DNA, and our DNA guides our cells to do the reactions that are needed for the existence of us, so the existence of life. If we lack this motor protein, our DNA will break, and we will lose necessary information that are inserted in our DNA. So I would like to end this talk by challenging you to work as this essential motor protein and pave the way for the new Swedes that are coming here so that we can all together type wonderful stories. Thank you very much.